This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. The Beatles were an English rock band, formed in Liverpool in 1960 with members John Lennon, Paul McCartney, George Harrison and Ringo Starr. They became widely regarded as the foremost and most influential act of the rock era rooted in skiffle, beat, and 1950s rock and roll. The Beatles later experimented with several musical styles, ranging from pop ballads and Indian music to psychedelia and hard rock, often incorporating classical elements and unconventional recording techniques in innovative ways. In the early 1960s, their enormous popularity first emerged as Beatlemania, but as the group's music grew in sophistication, led by primary songwriters Lennon and McCartney, they came to be perceived as an embodiment of the ideals shared by the counterculture of the 1960s. The Beatles built their reputation playing clubs in Liverpool and Hamburg over a three-year period from 1960, with Stuart Sutcliffe initially serving as bass player. The core of Lennon, McCartney and Harrison went through a succession of drummers, including Pete Best, before asking Starr to join them. Manager Brian Epstein molded them into a professional act, and producer George Martin guided and developed their recordings, greatly expanding their popularity in the United Kingdom after their first hit, Love Me Do. In late 1962, they acquired the nickname The Fab Four as Beatlemania grew in Britain the next year, and by early 1964 became international stars, leading the British invasion of the United States pop market from 1965 onwards. The Beatles produced increasingly innovative recordings, including the albums Rubber Soul 1965, Revolver 1966, Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band 1967, The Beatles commonly known as the White Album, 1968 and Abbey Road 1969. After their breakup in 1970, they each enjoyed successful musical careers of varying lengths. McCartney and Starr, the surviving members, remain musically active. Lennon was shot and killed in December 1980, and Harrison died of lung cancer in November 2001. According to the RIAA, the Beatles are the best-selling music artists in the United States, with 178 million certified units. They have had more number one albums on the British charts and sold more singles in the UK than any other act. In 2008, the group topped Billboard magazine's list of the all-time most successful Hot 100 artists. As of 2016, they hold the record for most number one hits on the Hot 100 chart with 20. They have received 10 Grammy Awards, an Academy Award for Best Original Song Score, and 15 Ivor Novello Awards, collectively included in Time magazine's compilation of the 20th century's 100 most influential people. They are the best-selling band in history, with estimated sales of over 600 million records worldwide. The group was inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in 1988, and all four were inducted individually from 1994 to 2015. Contents 1 History 11-1957-1962, Formation, Hamburg, and UK Popularity. 12-1963-1966, Beatlemania and Touring Years 121 Please Please Me and With the Beatles 122 British Invasion 123 A Hard Day's Night 124 Beatles for Sale, Help, and Rubber Soul 13-1966-1970, Controversy, Studio Years and Breakup 131 Events Leading Up to Final Tour 132 Revolver and Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band 133 Magical Mystery Tour, The White Album and Yellow Submarine 134 Abbey Road, Let It Be, and Breakup 14 1970 Present, After the Breakup 141 1970s 142 1980s 143 1990s 144 2000s 145 2010s 2 Musical Style and Development 21 Influences 22 Genres 23 Contribution of George Martin 24 In the Studio 3 Legacy 4 Awards and Achievements 5 Members 6 Discography 7 Song Catalog 8 Notes 9 Citations 10 Sources 11 Further Reading 12 External Links History 1957-1962, Formation, Hamburg, and UK Popularity History of the Beatles The Quarrymen in Hamburg at the Cavern Club Decca Audition Beatlemania in the United Kingdom North American Releases in the United States 1966 More Popular Than Jesus Studio Years in India Breakup Reunions Line-ups Religious Views Timeline VE in March 1957, John Lennon, then aged 16, formed a skiffle group with several friends. From Quarry Bank School, they briefly called themselves the Blackjacks, before changing their name to the Quarrymen after discovering that a respected local group was already using the other name. 15-year-old Paul McCartney joined as a rhythm guitarist shortly after he and Lennon met that July. In February 1958, McCartney invited his friend George Harrison to watch the band The 14-year-old audition for Lennon, impressing him with his playing, but Lennon initially thought Harrison was too young to join them. After a month of Harrison's persistence, they enlisted him as their lead guitarist by January 1959. Lennon's Quarry Bank friends had left the group, and he began studies at the Liverpool College of Art. The three guitarists, billing themselves at least three times as Johnny and the Moondogs, were playing rock and roll whenever they could find a drummer. Lennon's art school friend Stuart Sutcliffe, who had recently sold one of his paintings and was persuaded to purchase a bass guitar, joined in January 1960, and it was he who suggested changing the band's name to Beatles, as a tribute to Buddy Holly and the Crickets. They used the name until May, when they became the Silver Beatles, before undertaking a brief tour of Scotland as the backing group for pop singer and fellow Liverpudlian Johnny Gentle. By early July, they had changed their name to the Silver Beatles, and by the middle of August to the Beatles. Alan Williams, the Beatles' unofficial manager, arranged a residency for them in Hamburg, but lacking a full-time drummer, they auditioned and hired Pete Best in mid-August 1960. The band, now a five-piece, left 4 days later, contracted to club owner Bruno Koschmider for what would be a 3.5-month residency. Beatles historian Mark Lewison writes, "They pulled into Hamburg at dusk on the 17th of August, the time when the red light area comes to life." 1961, during their second Hamburg engagement, Kirchherr cut Sutcliffe's hair in the EXI existentialist style, later adopted by the other Beatles. When Sutcliffe decided to leave the band early that year and resume his art studies in Germany, McCartney took up the bass. Producer Bert Kaempfert contracted what was now a four-piece group through June 1962, and he used them as Tony Sheridan's backing band on a series of recordings for Polydor Records as part of the sessions. The Beatles were signed to Polydor for 1 year, credited to Tony Sheridan. From their contract in exchange for one last recording session in Hamburg, tragedy greeted them on their return to Germany in April, when a distraught Kirchherr met them at the airport with news of Sutcliffe's death the previous day from what would later be determined to have been a brain hemorrhage. Epstein began negotiations with record labels for a recording contract in order to secure a UK record contract. Epstein negotiated an early end to the band's contract with Polydor, in exchange for more recordings backing Tony Sheridan after a New Year's Day audition. Decca Records rejected the band with the comment, "Guitar groups are on the way out, Mr. Epstein." However, 3 months later, producer George Martin signed the Beatles to EMI's Parlophone label Abbey Road Studios. Main entrance. Martin's first recording session with the Beatles took place at EMI's Abbey Road Studios in London on 6 June 1962. Martin immediately complained to Epstein about Best's poor drumming and suggested they use a session drummer in his place, already contemplating Best's dismissal. The Beatles replaced him in mid-August with Ringo Starr, who left Rory Storm and the Hurricanes to join them. On the 4th of September, session at EMI yielded a recording of Love Me Do featuring Starr on drums, but a dissatisfied Martin hired drummer Andy White for the band's third session a week later, which produced recordings of Love Me Do, Please Please Me, and P.S. I Love You. Martin initially selected the Starr version of Love Me Do for the band's first single, though subsequent repressings featured the White version, with Starr on tambourine. Released in early October, Love Me Do peaked at number 17 on the record retailer chart. Their television debut came later that month with a live performance on the regional news program People and Places after Martin suggested re-recording Please Please Me at a faster tempo. A studio session in late November yielded that recording, of which Martin accurately predicted, "You've just made your first number one." In December 1962, the Beatles concluded their fifth and final Hamburg residency. By 1963, they had agreed that all four band members would contribute vocals to their albums, including Starr, despite his restricted vocal range. To validate his standing in the group, Lennon and McCartney had established a songwriting partnership, and as the band's success grew, their dominant collaboration limited Harrison's opportunities as a lead vocalist. Epstein, in an effort to maximize the Beatles' commercial potential, encouraged them to adopt a professional approach to performing. Lennon recalled him saying, "Look, if you really want to get in these bigger places, you're going to have to change. Stop eating on stage, stop swearing, stop smoking." Lennon said, "We used to dress how we liked. On and off stage he'd tell us that jeans were not particularly smart and could we possibly manage to wear proper trousers, but he didn't want us suddenly looking square. He'd let us have our own sense of individuality." 1963–1966, Beatlemania and touring years Please Please Me and With the Beatles. Their logo was based on an impromptu sketch by instrument retailer and designer Ivor Arbiter on the 11th of February 1963. The Beatles recorded 10 songs during a single studio session for their debut LP, Please Please Me. The album was supplemented by the four tracks already released on their first two singles. Martin originally considered recording the Beatles' debut LP live at the Cavern Club, but after deciding that the building's acoustics were inadequate, he elected to simulate a live album with minimal production in a single marathon session at Abbey Road. After the moderate success of Love Me Do, the single Please Please Me met with a more emphatic reception, released in January 1963, 2 months ahead of the album of the same name. The song reached number one on every chart in London except Record Retailer, where it stalled at number two, recalling how the Beatles rushed to deliver a debut album, bashing out Please Please Me in a day. AllMusic's Stephen Thomas Earlywine comments, decades after its release, the album still sounds fresh, precisely because of its intense origins. Lennon said little thought went into composition at the time. He and McCartney were just writing songs a la Everly Brothers, a la Buddy Holly, pop songs with no more thought of them than that, to create a sound, and the words were almost irrelevant. Released in March 1963, the album initiated a run during which 11 of their 12 studio albums released in the United Kingdom through 1970 reached number one. The band's third single, From Me to You, came out in April and was also a chart-topping hit, starting an almost unbroken string of 17 British number one singles for the Beatles, including all but one of the 18 they released over the next 6 years. Issued in August, the band's fourth single, She Loves You, achieved the fastest sales of any record in the UK up to that time, selling 750,000 copies in under 4 weeks. It became their first single to sell 1 million copies, and remained the biggest selling record in the UK until 1978, when Mull of Kintyre, by McCartney's post-Beatles band Wings, surpassed it in sales. Their commercial success brought increased media exposure, to which the Beatles responded with an irreverent and comical attitude that defied the expectations of pop musicians at the time, inspiring even more interest. The band toured the UK three times in the first half of the year, a four-week tour that began in February, the Beatles' first nationwide, preceded three-week tours in March and May to June as their popularity spread. A frenzied adulation of the group took hold, greeted with riotous enthusiasm by screaming fans. The press dubbed the phenomenon Beatlemania. Although not billed as tour leaders, the Beatles overshadowed American acts Tommy Rowe and Chris Montez during the February engagements and assumed top billing by audience demand, something no British act had previously accomplished. While touring with artists from the US, a similar situation arose during their May to June tour with Roy Orbison. McCartney, Harrison, Swedish pop singer Lil Babs, and Lennon on the set of the Swedish television show Drop In. The 30th of October 1963. In late October, the Beatles began a 5-day tour of Sweden, their first time abroad since the final Hamburg engagement of December 1962. On their return to the UK on the 31st of October, according to Lewison, several hundred screaming fans greeted them in heavy rain at Heathrow Airport. Around 50 to 100 journalists and photographers, as well as representatives from the BBC, also joined the airport reception, the first of more than 100 such events. The next day, the band began its fourth tour of Britain within 9 months, this one scheduled for 6 weeks in mid-November. As Beatlemania intensified, police resorted to using high-pressure water hoses to control the crowd before a concert in Plymouth. Please Please Me maintained the top position on the Record Retailer chart for 30 weeks, only to be displaced by its follow-up, With the Beatles, on the 22nd of November. Emmy released With the Beatles to record advance orders of 270,000 copies, and the LP topped a 500,000 albums sold in 1 week, recorded between July and October. With the Beatles made better use of studio production techniques than its predecessor. It held the top spot for 21 weeks with a chart life of 40 weeks. Earlywine described the LP as a sequel of the highest order, one that betters the original. In a reversal of then-standard practice, Emmy released the album ahead of the impending single I Want to Hold Your Hand, with the song excluded to maximize the single's sales. The album caught the attention of music critic William Mann of The Times, who suggested that Lennon and McCartney were the outstanding English composers of 1963. The newspaper published a series of articles in which Mann offered detailed analyses of the music, lending it respectability. With the Beatles became the second album in UK chart history to sell 1 million copies, a figure previously reached only by the 1958 South Pacific soundtrack. When writing the sleeve notes for the album, the band's press officer, Tony Barrow, used the superlative "the fabulous foursome," which the media widely adopted as "the Fab Four." British Invasion, EMI's American subsidiary, Capitol Records, hindered the Beatles' releases in the United States for more than a year by initially declining to issue their music, including their first three singles. Concurrent negotiations with the independent U.S. label VJ led to the release of some of the songs in 1963, but not all. VJ finished preparation for the album introducing the Beatles, culled from most of the songs of Parlophone's Please Please Me, but a management shake-up led to the album not being released then. When it surfaced that the label did not report royalties on their sales, the license VJ signed with EMI was voided. A new license was granted to the Swan label for the single She Loves You, but legal issues with royalties and publishing rights proved an obstacle to the successful marketing of the group in the U.S. American chart. Success began after Epstein arranged for a $40,000 U.S. marketing campaign and secured the support of disc jockey Carol James, who first played the band's records in mid-December 1963. Late that same month, the Beatles were introduced in the Tidewater area of Virginia by Gene Loving of radio station WGH, accompanied by a full marketing campaign, including Beatles shirt giveaways within days. Almost every other song played on the station was a Beatles recording. It was not until the end of first week of January 1964 that their records were played in New York City, also accompanied by a major marketing campaign and with similar play frequency, and then the rest of the country, initiating their music spread across U.S. radio. This caused an increase in demand, leading Capitol to rush release I Want to Hold Your Hand later that month, issued on the 26th of December 1963, with the band's previously scheduled debut there just weeks away. I Want to Hold Your Hand sold 1 million copies, becoming a number one hit in the U.S. by mid-January. In its wake, VJ released Introducing the Beatles to go along with Capitol's debut album, Meet the Beatles. While Swan reactivated production of She Loves You, the Beatles arrive at John F. Kennedy International Airport, the 7th of February 1964. On the 7th of February 1964, the Beatles left the United Kingdom with an estimated 4,000 fans gathered at Heathrow, waving and screaming as the aircraft took off upon landing at New York's John F. Kennedy Airport. An uproarious crowd estimated at 3,000 greeted them. They gave their first live U.S. television performance 2 days later on the Ed Sullivan Show, watched by approximately 73 million viewers in over 23 million households, or 34% of the American population. Biographer Jonathan Gould writes that, according to the Nielsen rating service, it was the largest audience that had ever been recorded for an American television program. The next morning, the Beatles awoke to a negative critical consensus in the U.S., but a day later their first U.S. concert saw Beatlemania erupt at Washington Coliseum. Back in New York the following day, the Beatles met with another strong reception during two shows at Carnegie Hall. The band then flew to Florida and appeared on the weekly Ed Sullivan Show a second time, before another 70 million viewers, before returning to the U.K. on the 22nd of February. A Hard Day's Night. Capitol Records' lack of interest throughout 1963 had not gone unnoticed, and a competitor, United Artists Records, encouraged their film division to offer the group a three-motion picture deal, primarily for the commercial potential of the soundtracks directed by Richard Lester. A Hard Day's Night involved the band for 6 weeks in March to April 1964 as they played themselves in a mock documentary. The film premiered in London and New York in July and August, respectively, and was an international success, with some critics drawing comparison with the Marx Brothers. According to Earlywine, the accompanying soundtrack album, A Hard Day's Night, saw them truly coming into their own as a band. All of the disparate influences on their first two albums had coalesced into a bright, joyous, original sound, filled with ringing guitars and irresistible melodies. That ringing guitar sound was primarily the product of Harrison's 12-string electric Rickenbacker, a prototype given to him by the manufacturer, which made its debut on the record during the week of 4 April 1964. The Beatles held 12 positions on the Billboard Hot 100 singles chart, including the top five. Their popularity generated unprecedented interest in British music, and a number of other UK acts subsequently made their own American debuts, successfully touring over the next 3 years in what was termed the British Invasion. occasion their hairstyle, unusually long for the era and mocked by many adults, became an emblem of rebellion to the burgeoning youth culture. McCartney, Harrison and Lennon perform on Dutch television in 1964, touring internationally in June and July. The Beatles staged 37 shows over 27 days in Denmark, the Netherlands, Hong Kong, Australia and New Zealand. In August they returned to the US, with a 30-concert tour of 23 cities generating intense interest once again. The month-long tour attracted between 10,000 and 20,000 fans to each 30-minute performance in cities from San Francisco to New York. In August, journalist Al Aronowitz arranged for the Beatles to meet Bob Dylan visiting the band in their New York hotel suite. Dylan introduced them to Cannabis. Gould points out the musical and cultural significance of this meeting, before which the musicians' respective fanbases were perceived as inhabiting two separate subcultural worlds. Dylan's audience of college kids with artistic or intellectual leanings, a dawning political and social idealism, and a mildly bohemian style contrasted with their fans, veritable teenyboppers, kids in high school or grade school whose lives were totally wrapped up in the commercialized popular culture of television, radio, pop records, fan magazines, and teen fashion. They were seen as idolaters, not idealists. Within 6 months of the meeting, Gould writes, Lennon would be making records on which he openly imitated Dylan's nasal drone, brittle strum, and introspective vocal persona. Within a year, Dylan would proceed, with the help of a five-piece group and a Fender Stratocaster electric guitar, to shake the monkey of folk authenticity permanently off his back. Conflict between the commercial pressures of their global success and their creative ambitions. They had intended the album, recorded between August and October 1964, to continue the format established by A Hard Day's Night, which, unlike the group's first two LPs, contained only original songs. The band had nearly exhausted their backlog of songs on the previous album, however, and given the challenges constant international touring posed to their songwriting efforts, Lennon admitted, material's becoming a hell of a problem. As a result, six covers from their extensive repertoire were chosen to complete the album released in early December. Its eight original compositions stood out, demonstrating the growing maturity of the Lennon-McCartney songwriting partnership. Together in 1965, celebrating a Grammy win in early 1965, while they were his guests for dinner, Lennon and Harrison's dentist secretly added LSD to their coffee. Lennon described the experience, "It was just terrifying, but it was fantastic. I was pretty stunned for a month or two." He and Harrison subsequently became regular users of the drug, joined by Starr on at least one occasion. McCartney was initially reluctant to try it, but eventually did so. In late 1966 he became the first Beatle to discuss LSD publicly, declaring in a magazine interview that "it opened my eyes and made me a better, more honest, more tolerant member of society." Controversy erupted in June 1965 when Queen Elizabeth II appointed all four Beatles members of the Order of the British Empire MBE after Prime Minister Harold Wilson nominated them for the award in protest. The honour was at that time primarily bestowed upon military veterans and civic leaders. Some conservative MBE recipients returned their own insignia, the US trailer for help, with from the rear Harrison, McCartney, Lennon and largely obscured Starr released in July. The Beatles' second film, Help, was again directed by Lester, described as mainly a relentless spoof of Bond. It inspired a mixed response among both reviewers and the band. McCartney said, "Help was great, but it wasn't our film. We were sort of guest stars. It was fun, but basically, as an idea for a film, it was a bit wrong." The soundtrack was dominated by Lennon, who wrote and sang lead on most of its songs, including the two singles, Help, and Ticket to Ride. The accompanying album, the group's fifth studio LP, contained all original material save for two covers, Act Naturally and Dizzy Miss Lizzy. They were the last covers the band would include on an album, with the exception of Let It Be's brief rendition of the traditional Liverpool folk song, Maggie May. The band expanded their use of vocal overdubs on Help, and incorporated classical instruments into some arrangements, including a string quartet on the pop ballad Yesterday, composed by McCartney. Yesterday would inspire the most recorded cover versions of any song ever written. The Beatles at a press conference in Bloomington, Minnesota. In August 1965, the group's third U.S. tour opened with a performance before a world record crowd of 55,600 at New York's Shea Stadium on 15 August 1965, perhaps the most famous of all Beatles concerts. In Lewison's description, a further nine successful concerts followed in other American cities. At a show in Atlanta, the Beatles gave one of the first live performances ever to make use of a foldback system of on-stage monitor speakers towards the end of the tour, they met with Elvis Presley, a foundational musical influence on the band, who invited them to his home in Beverly Hills. September saw the launch of an American Saturday morning cartoon series, The Beatles, that echoed A Hard Day's Night's slapstick antics over its two-year original run. The series was a historical milestone as the first weekly television series to feature animated versions of real, living people. Norwegian Wood. This bird has flown, sample of Norwegian Wood from Rubber Soul 1965. Harrison's use of a sitar on this song is representative of the Beatles' incorporation of unconventional instrumentation into rock music. Problems playing this file. See Media Help. In mid-October 1965, the Beatles entered the recording studio, for the first time when making an album. They had an extended period without other major commitments until this time. According to George Martin, "We had been making albums rather like a collection of singles. Now we were really beginning to think about albums as a bit of art on their own." Released in December, Rubber Soul has been hailed by critics as a major step forward in the maturity and complexity of the band's music. Their thematic reach was beginning to expand as they embraced deeper aspects of romance and philosophy. Biographers Peter Brown and Stephen Gaines attribute the new musical direction to the Beatles' now habitual use of marijuana, an assertion confirmed by the band. Lennon referred to it as the Pot Album, and Starr said, "Grass was really influential in a lot of our changes, especially with the writers, and because they were writing different material, we were playing differently." After Help's foray into the world of classical music with flutes and strings, Harrison's introduction of a sitar on Norwegian Wood. This Bird Has Flown marked a further progression outside the traditional boundaries of popular music as their lyrics grew more artful. Fans began to study them for deeper meaning of Norwegian Wood. Lennon commented, "I was trying to be sophisticated in writing about an affair." Collaborative songwriting, it also featured distinct compositions from each, though they continued to share official credit. The song, In My Life, of which each later claimed lead authorship, is considered a highlight of the entire Lennon-McCartney catalog. Harrison called Rubber Soul his favorite album, and Starr referred to it as the departure record. McCartney has said, "We'd had our cute period, and now it was time to expand." However, recording engineer Norman Smith later stated that the studio sessions revealed signs of growing conflict within the group. The clash between John and Paul was becoming obvious, he wrote, and, as far as Paul was concerned, George could do no right. In 2003, Rolling Stone ranked Rubber Soul fifth among the 500 greatest albums of all time, and AllMusic's Richie Unterberger describes it as one of the classic folk rock records. 1966-1970, controversy, studio years and breakup events leading up to final tour. Capitol Records, from December 1963 when it began issuing Beatles recordings for the U.S. market, exercised complete control over format, compiling distinct U.S. albums from the band's recordings and issuing songs of their choosing as singles. It was not until Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band in 1967 that a Beatles album was released with identical track listings in both the UK and the US. In June 1966, Yesterday and Today, one of Capitol's compilation albums, caused an uproar with its cover, which portrayed the grinning Beatles dressed in butcher's overalls, accompanied by raw meat and mutilated plastic baby dolls. It has been incorrectly suggested that this was meant as a satirical response to the way Capitol had butchered the U.S. versions of their albums. Thousands of copies of the LP had a new cover pasted over the original. An unpeeled First State copy fetched $10,500 at a December 2005 auction in England. Meanwhile, Harrison met sitar maestro Ravi Shankar, who agreed to train him on the instrument during a tour of the Philippines the month after the Yesterday and Today furore. The Beatles unintentionally snubbed the nation's first lady, Imelda Marcos, who had expected them to attend a breakfast reception at the presidential palace. When presented with the invitation, Epstein politely declined on the band members' behalf, as it had never been his policy to accept such official invitations. They soon found that the Marcos regime was unaccustomed to taking no for an answer. The resulting riots endangered the group, and they escaped the country with difficulty. Immediately afterwards, the band members visited India for the first time almost as soon as they returned home. The Beatles faced a fierce backlash from U.S. religious and social conservatives as well as the Ku Klux Klan over a comment Lennon had made in a March interview with British reporter Maureen Cleave. "Christianity will go," Lennon had said, "it will vanish and shrink. I needn't argue about that. I'm right and I will be proved right. Where more popular than Jesus now, I don't know which will go first, rock and roll or Christianity." Jesus was all right, but his disciples were thick and ordinary. It's them twisting it that ruins it for me. The comment went virtually unnoticed in England, but when US teenage fan magazine Datebook printed it 5 months later, on the eve of the group's August US tour, it sparked a controversy with Christians in the American Bible Belt. The Vatican issued a protest, and bans on Beatles records were imposed by Spanish and Dutch stations and South Africa's national broadcasting service. Epstein accused Datebook of having taken Lennon's words out of context. At a press conference, Lennon pointed out, "If I'd said television was more popular than Jesus, I might have got away with it." Lennon claimed that he was referring to how other people viewed their success, but at the prompting of reporters, he concluded, "If you want me to apologize, if that will make you happy, then okay, I'm sorry." As preparations were made for the U.S. tour, the Beatles knew that their music would hardly be heard having originally used Vox AC-30 amplifiers. They later acquired more powerful 100-watt amplifiers, specially designed by Vox for them as they moved into larger venues in 1964, but these were still inadequate, struggling to compete with the volume of sound generated by screaming fans. The band had grown increasingly bored with the routine of performing live, recognizing that their shows were no longer about the music. They decided to make the August tour their last Revolver and Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band Eleanor Rigby sample of Eleanor Rigby from Revolver 1966. The album involves innovative compositional approaches, arrangements, and recording techniques. This song, primarily written by McCartney, prominently features classical strings in a novel fusion of musical styles. Problems playing this file. See Media Help. Rubber Soul had marked a major step forward. Revolver, released in August 1966, a week before the Beatles' final tour, marked another Pitchfork. Scott Plagenhoff identifies it as the sound of a band growing into supreme confidence and redefining what was expected from popular music. Revolver featured sophisticated songwriting, studio experimentation, and a greatly expanded repertoire of musical styles, ranging from innovative classical string arrangements to psychedelic rock. Abandoning the customary group photograph, its cover, designed by Klaus Voormann, a friend of the band since their Hamburg days, was a stark, arty, black and white collage that caricatured the Beatles in a pen and ink style beholden to Aubrey Beardsley. In Gold's description, the album was preceded by the single Paperback Writer, backed by Rain. Short promotional films were made for both songs, described by cultural historian Saul Austerlitz as among the first true music videos. They aired on The Ed Sullivan Show and Top of the Pops in June 1966 at EMI Studios with George Martin in 1966. Among the experimental songs that Revolver featured was Tomorrow Never Knows, the lyrics for which Lennon drew from Timothy Leary's The Psychedelic Experience, a manual based on the Tibetan Book of the Dead. Its creation involved 8 tape decks distributed about the EMI building, each staffed by an engineer or band member, who randomly varied the movement of a tape loop while Martin created a composite recording by sampling the incoming data. McCartney's Eleanor Rigby made prominent use of a string octet. Gould describes it as a true hybrid, conforming to no recognizable style or genre of song. Harrison was developing as a songwriter, and 3 of his compositions earned a place on the record in 2003. Rolling Stone ranked Revolver as the 3rd greatest album of all time during the US tour that followed its release. However, the band performed none of its songs. As Chris Ingham writes, they were very much studio creations. Included over 1,400 concert appearances internationally. Freed from the burden of touring, the Beatles embraced an increasingly experimental approach as they recorded Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band, beginning in late November 1966. According to engineer Jeff Emerick, the album's recording took over 700 hours. He recalled the band's insistence that everything on Sgt. Pepper had to be different. "We had microphones right down in the bells of brass instruments and headphones turned into microphones attached to violins. We used giant primitive oscillators to vary the speed of instruments and vocals, and we had tapes chopped to pieces and stuck together upside down and the wrong way around." Parts of A Day in the Life featured a 40-piece orchestra. The sessions initially yielded the non-album double A-side single Strawberry Fields Forever, Penny Lane in February 1967. The Sgt. Pepper LP followed in June. The musical complexity of the records, created using relatively primitive 4-track recording technology, astounded contemporary artists. For Beach Boys leader Brian Wilson, then in the midst of a personal crisis and struggling at the time to complete the ambitious Smile, hearing Strawberry Fields was reported as one of many elements that contributed to the project's collapse among music critics. Acclaim for the album was virtually universal. Gould writes, "The overwhelming consensus is that the Beatles had created a popular masterpiece, a rich Sustained, an overflowing work of collaborative genius whose bold ambition and startling originality dramatically enlarged the possibilities and raised the expectations of what the experience of listening to popular music on record could be. On the basis of this perception, Sgt. Pepper became the catalyst for an explosion of mass enthusiasm for album-formatted rock that would revolutionize both the aesthetics and the economics of the record business in ways that far outstripped the earlier pop explosions triggered by the Elvis phenomenon of 1956 and the Beatlemania phenomenon of 1963. Front cover of Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band, the most famous cover of any music album, and one of the most imitated images in the world. Sgt. Pepper was the first major pop rock LP to include its complete lyrics, which appeared on the back cover. Those lyrics were the subject of critical analysis. For instance, in late 1967, the album was the subject of a scholarly inquiry by American literary critic and professor of English Richard Poirier, who observed that his students were listening to the group's music with a degree of engagement that he, as a teacher of literature, could only envy. Poirier identified what he termed its mixed elusiveness, its unwise ever to assume that they're doing only one thing or expressing themselves in only one style. We write songs, we know what we mean by them, but in a week someone else says something about it, and you can't deny it. Been worse if they had heard that their own fathers had dropped dead, Brian had found them, believed in them, molded them, turned them into millionaires, and made them famous the world over. We knew that life would never be the same again. Patty Boyd, wife of George Harrison. 2 days later, their manager's assistant, Peter Brown, phoned to inform them that Epstein, only 32 years old, had died. The coroner ruled the death an accidental carbidol overdose, although it was widely rumored to be a suicide. Epstein had been in a fragile emotional state, stressed by personal issues. His death left the group disoriented and fearful about the future, Lennon recalled. We collapsed. I knew that we were in trouble then. I didn't really have any misconceptions about our ability to do anything other than play music, and I was scared. I thought, we've had it now. Magical Mystery Tour, the White Album and Yellow Submarine. Magical Mystery Tour, the soundtrack to a forthcoming Beatles television film, was released in the UK as a 6-track double extended play disc EP in early December 1967 in the United States. The 6 songs were issued on an identically titled LP that also included 5 tracks from the band's recent singles. Unterberger says of the US Magical Mystery Tour, the psychedelic sound is very much in the vein of Sgt. Pepper, and even spacier in parts, especially the sound collages of I Am the Walrus, and he calls its 5 songs culled from the band's 1967 singles Huge, Glorious, and Innovative. In its first 3 weeks, the album set a record for the highest initial sales of any Capitol LP, and it is the only Capitol compilation later to be adopted in the band's official canon of studio albums. First aired on Boxing Day, the Magical Mystery Tour film, largely directed by McCartney, brought the group their first major negative UK press. It was dismissed as blatant rubbish by the Daily Express, the Daily Mail called it a colossal conceit, and the Guardian labeled the film a kind of fantasy morality play about the grossness and warmth and stupidity of the audience. Gould describes it as a great deal of raw footage showing a group of people getting on, getting off, and riding on a bus. Although the viewership figures were respectable, its slating in the press led U.S. television networks to lose interest in broadcasting the film in January 1968. The Beatles filmed a cameo for the animated movie Yellow Submarine, which featured cartoon versions of the band members and a soundtrack with 11 of their songs, including 4 unreleased studio recordings that made their debut in the film released in June 1968. The film was praised by critics for its music, humor, and innovative visual style. It would be 7 months, however, before the film's soundtrack album appeared. The Beatles, known as the White Album for its minimalist cover, conceived by pop artist Richard Hamilton, in direct contrast to Sgt. Pepper, while also suggesting a clean slate. In the interim came The Beatles, a double LP commonly known as the White Album for its virtually featureless cover. Creative inspiration for the album came from a new direction. Without Epstein's guiding presence, the group had briefly turned to Maharishi Mahesh Yogi as their guru at his ashram in Rishikesh, India. A guide course, scheduled for 3 months, marked one of their most prolific periods, yielding numerous songs, including a majority of the 30 included on the album. However, Starr left after only 10 days, likening it to Butlins, and McCartney eventually grew bored and departed a month later for Lennon and Harrison. Creativity turned to questioning when an electronics technician known as Magic Alex suggested that the Maharishi was attempting to manipulate them when he alleged that the Maharishi had made sexual advances to women attendees. A persuaded Lennon left abruptly just 2 months into the course, bringing an unconvinced Harrison and the remainder of the group's entourage with him in anger. Lennon wrote a scathing song titled Maharishi, renamed Sexy Sadie to avoid potential legal issues. McCartney said, "We made a mistake. We thought there was more to him than there was." During recording sessions for the White Album, which stretched from late May to mid-October 1968, relations between the Beatles grew openly divisive. Starr quit for 2 weeks, and McCartney took over the drum kit for Back in the USSR, on which Harrison and Lennon drummed as well, and Dear Prudence. Lennon had lost interest in collaborating with McCartney, whose contribution Obla-dee, Obla-daw, he scorned as granny music shit. Tensions were further aggravated by Lennon's romantic preoccupation with avant-garde artist Yoko Ono, whom he insisted on bringing to the sessions despite the group's well-established understanding that girlfriends were not allowed in the studio. Describing the double album, Lennon later said, "Every track is an individual track, there isn't any Beatle music on it. John and the band, Paul and the band, George and the band." McCartney has recalled that the album wasn't a pleasant one to make. Both he and Lennon identified the sessions as the start of the band's breakup. Issued in November, the White Album was the band's first Apple Records album release. Although EMI continued to own their recordings, the new label was a subsidiary of Apple Corp., which Epstein had formed as part of his plan to create a tax-effective business structure. The record attracted more than 2 million advance orders, selling nearly 4 million copies in the U.S. in little over a month, and its tracks dominated the playlists of American radio stations. Despite its popularity, it did not receive flattering reviews at the time. According to Gould, the critical response didn't know what to make of this shapeless outpouring of songs. Newsweek's Hubert Saul, citing the high proportion of parodies, accused the group of getting their tongues caught in their cheeks. General critical opinion eventually turned in favor of the White Album, and in 2003, Rolling Stone ranked it as the 10th greatest album of all time. Pitchfork's Mark Richardson describes it as large and sprawling, overflowing with ideas but also with indulgences, and filled with a hugely variable array of material. Mellotron, larger-than-life percussion, and tidal waves of feedback guitar. They cease work at Twickenham and relocate to the newly finished Apple studio. The other band members agreed, and the idea came about to salvage the footage shot for the TV production for use in a feature film. Apple Corp. building at 3 Savile Row, site of the Let It Be rooftop concert. In an effort to alleviate tensions within the band and improve the quality of their live sound, Harrison invited keyboardist Billy Preston to participate in the last 9 days of sessions. Preston received label billing on the Get Back single, the only musician ever to receive that acknowledgement on an official Beatles release. At the conclusion of the rehearsals, the band could not agree on a location to film a concert, rejecting several ideas, including a boat at sea, a lunatic asylum, the Tunisian desert, and the Colosseum. Ultimately, what would be their final live performance was filmed on the rooftop of the Apple Corp. building at 3 Savile Row, London, on 30 January 1969. 5 weeks later, engineer Glyn Johns, whom Lewison describes as Get Back's uncredited producer, began work assembling an album, given free rein as the band all but washed their hands of the entire project. New strains developed between the band members regarding the appointment of a financial advisor, the need for which had become evident without Epstein to manage business affairs. Lennon, Harrison and Starr favored Alan Klein, who had managed the Rolling Stones and Sam Cooke. McCartney wanted Lee and John Eastman, father and brother, respectively, of Linda Eastman, whom McCartney married on the 12th of March. Agreement could not be reached, so both Klein and the Eastmans were temporarily appointed, Klein as the Beatles' business manager and the Eastmans as their lawyers. Further conflict ensued, however, and financial opportunities were lost. On the 8th of May, Klein was named sole manager of the band, the Eastmans having previously been dismissed as the Beatles' attorneys. McCartney refused to sign the management contract with Klein, but he was outvoted by the other Beatles. Martin stated that he was surprised when McCartney asked him to produce another album, as the Get Back sessions had been a miserable experience and he had thought it was the end of the road for all of us. The primary recording sessions for Abbey Road began on 2 July 1969. Lennon, who rejected Martin's proposed format of a continuously moving piece of music, wanted his and McCartney's songs to occupy separate sides of the album, the eventual format, with individually composed songs on the first side and the second consisting largely of a medley, was McCartney's suggested compromise on 4 July. The first solo single by a Beatle was released, Lennon's Give Peace a Chance, credited to the Plastic Ono band The Completion and mixing of I Want You She's So Heavy on 20 August 1969 was the last occasion on which all four Beatles were together in the same studio. Lennon announced his departure to the rest of the group on 20 September, but agreed to withhold a public announcement to avoid undermining sales of the forthcoming album. Released 6 days after Lennon's declaration, Abbey Road sold 4 million copies within 3 months and topped the UK charts for a total of 17 weeks. Its second track, the ballad Something, was issued as a single, the only Harrison composition ever to appear as a Beatles A-side. Abbey Road received mixed reviews, although the medley met with general acclaim. Unterberger considers it a fitting swan song for the group, containing some of the greatest harmonies to be heard on any rock record. Musicologist and author Ian MacDonald calls the album erratic and often hollow, despite the semblance of unity and coherence offered by the medley. Martin has singled it out as his personal favorite of all the band's albums. Lennon said it was competent but had no life in it. Recording engineer Emmerich notes that the replacement of the studio's valve mixing console with a transistorized one yielded a less punchy sound, leaving the group frustrated at the thinner tone and lack of impact and contributing to its kinder, gentler feel relative to their previous albums. For the still unfinished Get Back album, one last song, Harrison's I Me Mine, was recorded on 3 January 1970. Lennon, in Denmark at the time, did not participate in March, rejecting the work Johns had done on the project, now retitled Let It Be. Klein gave the session tapes to American producer Phil Spector, who had recently produced Lennon's solo single Instant.